Welcome, everyone. Thank you for taking this night to share this beautiful presence with us. We've got a nice little cozy clubhouse, courtesy of Jen, who's our host. And Chris and Bao are here, living pretty close in this area with Serena, and so we just feel we are so among friends. And Anna has traveled here from Camas, Utah, bringing her guitar and her presence and joy to share and collaborate. Maybe I saw some collaborations with Charles coming along here too, do a lot of music. And Helena and I have not joined together in a gathering for a year and a half. And we have traveled all over the world, and we did it for years, so it's very, very precious time for us to come together and spend these days just in the presence and a lot of deep meditation, and then to just come out and share with you. And tonight, too, I just feel like it will be a celebration. We have so much amazing music here to share with you this evening. And also just to join with you in the deepest prayer of our heart to let this be a blessing to God and a song of rejoicing, really, that we share. And yeah, it's the first time I've been out here for a while, but I recognize a lot of familiar faces, and it's just so precious for me to come out again to this area, because I've been doing quite a bit of traveling, and Helena's come all the way from Sweden, a long way. You want to just greet everyone or share anything?
Yeah, it's so nice to be back here. Yeah, it's been so joyful being here in this area, and I know sharing music here has just been a joy in my heart, and I'm looking forward to do that tonight too. Yeah. Yeah, and I'm just so happy to be here with David as well. We traveled we lived together for 4 years, 24/7, and traveling around the world, and so it feels wonderful to be here again. And so, yeah, thank you.
And we've chosen this site to kick off what we're calling a Quantum Love Tour. So that's a song that came through Kirsten, and it's something that we all feel. It's such a huge, expansive love. Sometimes it goes for agape love or unconditional love, but here, now we're getting a little scientific too. Quantum love. Put those words together. We were talking about technology earlier. It's going smaller and smaller. It's going into rings and watches now, and we can put quantum love together. It's bigger than the two of us. Love radiates undefined, because we all know that love can't be defined and God can't be defined, and so this love is so huge and so expansive, it goes way beyond any concepts we have in this world. But happily, we're opening to it. We're coming into this experience of it as a living presence, and so that's something to really rejoice with. So, as usual, we just really come and ask that the Spirit use us and join with all of you in this deep presence, and then open it up just to be given over to the Spirit to be used. So it's a big collaborative effort. In a quantum way, we've all chosen this, and tonight I pray that this will be a great expression of the love and the joy that we have, that we keep sharing and extending. And we're so grateful that you can be part of the kickoff of our Quantum Love Tour. It's going to go all over the East Coast, and so this is kind of our West Coast launch. And I think there in the early days, I was doing a lot of what I called hippity-hop travel, and Helena was part of a lot of that, because we were literally sometimes going from place to place, night to night, sometimes from country to country, even skipping around. And then we went through a phase of doing more deeper retreats, you know, like 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, then 4 weeks, and then a 6 week retreat. We kind of went the other direction. People go, 6 week retreat. My God, it's like a little mini community. Yeah, that's the way people felt. They were ready to just kind of have a little community there when we ended that one. So those were very precious. And then now it seems like after kind of hosting people, so many people that have come to live with us in community and practice these principles, including, we say, no private thoughts and no people-pleasing, it seems to be swinging around more to an extending phase. Maybe to use a technological word, a digital, like we're a digital community. We just like to share and extend, but it seems to be going and swinging more. So that's what this Quantum Love Tour is kind of kicking off. So, yeah, how shall we open it up tonight? With a song? Okay. That would be nice. We've got so much music tonight, I think it's a good only right to kick it off with a song.
This song is about saying yes to being the bliss, saying yes to be with God, which is the same thing, being with Him and His heart together, being God's heart, living, breathing in it. I say yes.
With you.
and then we can share the joy. After we said yes. That's very good, thank you.
Yeah, that's great. But that is it. That this is such a journey of clearing out the mind, emptying the mind of everything that's unlike God. And joining with Helena, we were just reminiscing too, talking a bit with Jen the other night at the dinner table, that this journey seems to be through the darkness to the light, and I think that's something that most everyone can relate to, the intensity of the darkness coming up, and in order to really have a consistent experience of reverence and devotion and joy, takes so much clearing away and so much faith to really hang in there. And yeah, it feels good. We've really hung in there through everything. That's what the mystics call the dark night of the soul. And if you really go for it and you just live your life in such devotion, then the darkness will rear up. In fact, you were sharing those some experiences from recently in Sweden, where the spirit was ripping through so strong, but then you might call it ego backlash or ego whiplash, whatever you want to call it, comes up because there's such a terror of the light. And yet that's so essential, using relationships, using everything, all the reflections of this world, and not avoiding anything. And so that's been something that we've really looked at and gone through in this experience of coming to clarity, and a constant state of clarity really requires an empty mind. You can't really hold on to any kind of grievances or idols. And that's what I've been saying recently. It's like even going on tour, you have to experience yourself as that presence in order to really extend. It's not about words or anything else. It's just about that. So I thought, yeah, we're here to just as transparent vessels and an open book to join with you tonight. And I think after that song, maybe we'll just open it up a little bit. If anybody has any topics or areas that you'd like to explore deeply, we're here to join with you in that. I know there's always these little thoughts whirling around, and it's great to just get some depth and clarity so you can get underneath them and really sink down deep. So just to start off, are there any questions?
I just feel like I just have so much to say, and I don't know how to say it, but I know I lack nothing, but I feel like I lack these relationships that y'all have with someone who can you can talk to and share with. Because I have relationships, and my stuff comes up with them the best I can, but. And I know I'm under no laws but God, so why am I so fat? You know, it's not about what I eat and my exercise. I'm under no laws but God. I practice. I love this life that I'm living today through understanding and just growing. But, you know, why do people get so fat? Is it because my ego needs to learn some humility and give up the vanity and pride stuff? I mean, like I said, I sit and I journal and I make progress. I don't understand it intellectually too much. It just gets revealed to me in a way I can't, like, verbalize. But I'm very attracted to your no compromising. And I'm never anywhere by accident. I'm always right where I'm supposed to be at the right time. And my life is so different now. And I'm in this journey and I have complete faith that I'm going to get through. And I want to not care about my appearance or what I look like. It doesn't matter. It's not who I am, right? That's nothing to do with who I am. It's just an image. Everything is just an image. But, I mean, y'all talk about the fat. I mean, it might be suicide for someone. I mean, but good gracious, that's one of the worst things you could possibly be, right? But now, look at me, I just go more and more and more. It's got to be just the leveling of the pride, right? Thank you for letting me share. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just the loosening. I mean, last night I showed a quantum physics kind of relationship movie, and if you get a broader perspective, you start to see that the things that seem so magnified and important in this world, you know, around the body and the lifestyle and many things. I was telling the group last night that there was a point where Helen Schuckman was like flying with Jesus past time so quickly that they almost missed her, flew past her entire lifetime as Helen Schuckman, and she almost missed it. It was so insignificant because it was in the overall context of things, but the ego just blows things way out of proportion. And it's this thing about form and content, you know, love is content, and the ego made the form, it made the body, and the ego is self-hatred, so it hates the body. Even when it tries to control the weight of the body, or control the shape, or the beauty, and all these different things, in many ways, it's still, this self-hatred is still in the mind, and it has to be raised up to awareness, to the light, and released. And so it's good to start to think more of the body as a communication device, and like St. Francis's prayer, Lord, make me an instrument, where you start to focus more on what is it that I would convey, what kind of attitudes would I share, what kind of attitudes and thoughts and ideas would I extend, because ideas are strengthened as they're shared. And it starts to take the focus off of the body and how the body looks and the form of the body, and it starts to focus more and more on the purpose. What is the purpose of the body? It's just a communication device. Until the mind becomes so whole and healed that it doesn't even need the body at all anymore. It's just a temporary communication device. And so, to me, that was very, very important as I began just answering my calling, was to be spoken through, to let the Holy Spirit speak through me and laugh through me and smile through me and hug through me. And you can start to feel your heart warming up and you get the warm fuzzies from getting into that purpose. And then it just slowly pulls your attention away from the body and the world, because the ego has used that as a way to project. You know, we've all heard of psychosomatic kind of illnesses, and really the mind is sick. And then when that torment is not relieved, then it seems to do the trick of trying to project it out to the body. And then there's a lot more attention paid to the body, even more attention to a sick body or a body that feels uncomfortable. And it's just like a trap of keeping the mind so distracted and so caught up into the form that it doesn't pay attention to the thoughts and the beliefs. Now, you were saying you would love to have somebody you could really talk to like that. Well, with our communities and also even with online stuff like our Mystical Mind Training program, we have mind training partners. Sometimes they're in different time zones or in different countries. Sometimes they live very close. As we've got Rebecca and Jen are maybe 5 or 10 minutes away, and they do mystical mind training. But the spirit really helps bring people together in a way that you can teach and learn and relate to what you're teaching and learning. So even people that live in remote areas can get paired up with people through Skype or through the phone or through ways where there's a real sense of growing together, learning together, being able to express things. And even when trust builds, to help each other out, sometimes even to point things out. I'm sure that happens occasionally where you can speak to that, where you... there's enough love and trust in that little relationship that you can start to help point things out or remind. And then it starts to really speed up the mind training in a big way. So I think that just speaks to what you're saying. That's where the focus comes. And then the more you get focused in on that, then other things. You still, you know, will do things to help bring about some comfort. Things that the world would call even practical. I've had friends who, you know, they had to watch their diet, watch their blood pressure, exercise, those kind of things that come in. Those are all still magical because really only the mind is causative. But the spirit works with the mind where it believes it's at. And so you can start to get intuitive feelings of things that you feel more comfortable with and more helpful in your life. Still, you need a sense of purpose. You got to answer your calling to build that momentum and start to feel that confidence in the spirit for the journey, because it's going to be a very deep journey inward. And it's just great that you've come here tonight, you know, just to be among your mighty companions.
Yeah, I only came 3,000 miles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From North Carolina, you took a bus, huh? Yeah.
A bus.
You took a bus here?
Yeah. From North Carolina.
From North Carolina. Oh my. See, now that's a lot of persistence and willingness.
That's determination.
I trust God. I want to just trust God. And at home, everything's in place. That's why I think now I just feel hungry and I eat and I got my big easy chair and everything's handled. Like, yeah, I trust God. He's had, he takes keys, giving me everything, you know. Now I need to, I don't know, I got to do something different where I really am trusting him. You know, I'm like, I live like a queen on a tiny bit of money. And I'm proud of how I stretch my money and I save a little money. And anyway, I've trusted him since I've been here. And right, like now, I don't know where I'll be staying tonight, but I will not regret doing this. Like I said, I sitting at home trying to figure it out on my own. It's just, I have to go. I have to follow his lead and trust him and just get more of that experience. And that's what I intend to keep doing.
Nice. That's great. You know, Molly wrote me an email. She said, okay, I'm going to connect with you. And that's how it starts. Just the willingness to connect. You know, we connect over an email and then all kinds of miracles have come in just through that connection. And the spirit so wants to lift us up, so wants to connect with us, you know, doesn't want us to stay trapped or feel confined, feel limited, wants us to take us on a journey. And I've shared, you know, in my life, you know, the David character was very shy, voted most quiet in the senior class, a wallflower, and kind of, you know, didn't like travel, absolutely did not like travel, and all these things, and everyone knows the story, Moses stuttered, you know, and he was to deliver the Ten Commandments. I mean, it's not so much, we don't have to have like a spiritual resume to say to God, okay, you know, can you use me? The Spirit knows us better than we know ourselves and can work with us and lift us higher and higher and higher if we're just willing, if we're just willing to take the steps. And I think you are willing. Yes. So, I mean, if you come from North Carolina for this gathering, I see tremendous willingness there. So. The ego's shaking a little bit there. You know? It's like, whoa, watch out, Jesus means business now.
I already have my ticket for when you come to the East Coast here in May, in Greensboro, that's close to me.
Okay, quantum tour, you're going to be at both ends. San Rafael and a group piece. Yes, in the back, way in the back.
What I want to say is this is just unreal, is that I have been thinking for the last 2 months that I wanted to have a friend in the South that I could connect with. Because I loved it so much when I was there, and I never felt so loved in my life. I was there 1 hour, and I was talking like I'd lived there my whole life. And I want to have a friend in the South that I can have as a pen pal, a connection, a best girlfriend.
I'm entering this new phase of life. I've got my children raised up, and I have a home. God has, he pays the bills. He's his house. He lets me stay there. And I wanted to like turn it into a place where other people who stay the course can just come and stay there. It's not mine, it's his. And like I say, this is the next thing. This is all I want to do anymore, is grow through the Course in Miracles and interact with other people and shine light and get brighter and heal the mind. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for bringing that up. There it is right there. It's just bubbling miracles, cascading, rippling, the ripple effect. Yeah. Yeah.
I think the beauty in that is the trust and the faith. Take that step. Take the first step. I forget who said that. It's about taking that first step.
Yeah.
Can't climb a ladder unless you take that first step.
Yeah, that's true. Well, we've got so much great music to share. I'm thinking, do you have the song that relates to this?
Yes.
Yes.
And do you need collaborators for it?
One?
Yeah.
Charles.
You have heard.
Yeah, it's really a walk of just building trust in the spirit. And it takes experience, it takes new experiences to build that trust. And when I look at how our lives have seemed to go, that really stands out for me. In my travels, and then recently Helena took some travels with her band, The Open Heart, in Europe, including buying a used motorhome and all the adventures. And it reminds me of my days, early days of travel, because we're having to learn to let go of our past learning and become more focused on the present moment and the trust of the guidance that's within us, as opposed to our past learning that wants to tell us how we have to do things all the time. I thought maybe you had such glee and joy taking that trip. It was such a walk of faith and trust, but there were so many miracles, like so many every day, that it starts to give you the feel of practical everyday miracles, and then that's what leads you in your life. That's what helps build the confidence. I thought maybe before we open up our next question, you could just share a little bit about that tour you took.
Sure. Yeah, it was the most amazing thing. We were given a motorhome. My mother, she donated a motorhome, and it was from 1987. So it had many years on it, and when we were going to drive on this 1 month long tour throughout Europe, the first day we were going to pick it up, we came from Spain to pick it up in Sweden, and it had stood there for like a month in Sweden during winter time, and we could not get it started first of all, and I was like, oh, not a problem, it'll get started, and yeah, we get started, and we got all the help, and then we came to the cabin where we were staying, and the guys in the back, they were like, Helena, we didn't really dare to say this, but it rained in here, and we thought that maybe it's okay, but it's really raining in, you know, inside the motorhome, because they were sitting in the back, right? So they had rain coming in, and we were like, oh, and Al and I, we went back in the motorhome and looked at the ceiling. The whole ceiling was filled with water. The whole ceiling and the walls. Oh. And it was like literally dripping. And we were like, whoa, and we're going to live in this motorhome for 1 month. But you know what? I feel so calm. I feel so peaceful. It's like, it just feels good, you know? And so Al, he just took a towel and he just dried off in the ceiling and on the walls. And then they were like they had an expression session there when he was doing the towel. And it was like this beautiful joining. It was just like this, that nothing can touch us. It's just unless we choose to have that touching us. That's like our decision. If we just want to be present with whatever is, this is like our choice. So that was just the first night. And then it just continued. I mean, I don't even remember all of the things now, but I do remember when we came to England and we were stopping at a gas station. And all of a sudden, when we were going to start it again, it didn't say anything. The car literally didn't say anything. It didn't even say, you know, not even that. It was just like, quiet. Nothing happened at all. So we were like, whoa, okay, let's see here what it is. And straight away, Ludwig, he heard, what was it called? Motor starter. He heard motor starter. He knows nothing about car. He was just like, motor starter. And maybe it's not called that. I don't know. Yeah. I think. And so we were like, okay. And then after some time, these guys drove up right next to the car. And they were like in such a joy. And they have like music going on. And he was like so resonating with them. And he was like, I think we're going to ask them if they can help us. And he was like hesitating. I was, of course, let's go out there and ask them, you know, okay, let's trust this. And so the guy was like asking three questions. And then he was on to it. He was like, donk, donk, and on the right spot and everything. And, of course, we could just drive off then. And, I mean, it was just like all of the time these things that when we actually arrived in Sweden, we'd had so many miracles with this car. On and on and on and on. And Ludwig, he was going into it in the middle of the evening, very late, and it was dark. And he opened up the cupboard, and he saw it sparkling inside there. It was literally sparks going in there, inside of the closet with all of the water, with all of the paper plates standing there, right next to the sparks. And he was like, whoa, what's going on? I mean, we'd had the heat not working for like half of the month that we've been traveling, but we were like, oh, well, it'll fix. It'll fix somehow. We didn't know what it was. And then it was this thing. We took it to the car place where we've had this guy that have helped us with all kinds of things. I mean, literally, it's just he's just been jumping right in, putting in a new stereo for us, not needing to pay anything, putting in a new sound system, like loudspeakers, not needing to pay anything. And so he said, let me have a look at it. And he was like looking at it. And we had literally a fire going on in this motorhome. A fire without nodding. We didn't even know. It was like a fire within the cables. So we just felt so carried that it doesn't even matter if it's like a fire. We're like totally clueless, right? We're just so safe in the hands of God. And that's just everything that we can trust on. And then whatever else can happen in the form, and it can look however it is. But every time we talked about the car, every time we had a miracle about it, it became the spark in our heart. So we started actually calling the motorhome, the spark. So that was the name of it. And many, many more miracles with it, but I can just tell you some of them. And just this, of the convincing job of the Spirit that there's nothing else that we can lean up on but Him, and that He carries us through everything. Yeah.
Really? You're right by a microphone. Do you want to?
Oh, no.
No, you're just helping out. Okay. Okay.
I'm listening.
You're just listening. Very good. Okay, does anybody else have anything else they'd like to explore? Yes, back on the couch. Hi there.
Hi, I'd just like to, I'm a little confused because when you talk about clearing your mind, and I have a lot of things going on regarding the corruption in the court, doing a lot of things to me, and taking a lot away from me, illegally. And of course my mind is full of this. And I don't know how it would relate having a clear mind and having to do all that work.
Well, I know for me, working with A Course in Miracles for over 25 years, that one of the lines that is in the Course in Miracles from Jesus is, beware of the temptation to perceive yourself unfairly treated. And because it always involves a lot of stress and a lot of anger, and you know, it's almost like the ego starts building a case as soon as there's the misperception of being unfairly treated. So we know that it's a very high teaching that all things work together for good. But to actually go through the experience, we have to allow those feelings that you're feeling to come up. And we have to get into a practice of, you might call it mind training, of learning to substitute other thoughts in place of the thoughts that we have where the grievances are, and the hurt, and the anger. So, the practice I did when I was doing the workbook lessons, I'm thinking of one particular lesson, which is, I can be hurt by nothing but my thoughts. It's a really good initial thought to start to begin to train ourselves that nobody else is upsetting us, nobody else is harming us. There's nothing of the world, no people, no places, no things. But it's our perception, our distorted perception, that's coming from our distorted thoughts that needs the healing. And that's why in Buddhism they talk about emptying the mind, and the same thing with A Course in Miracles. But you have to have the allowance first to let the thoughts come up into awareness. And it takes a lot of faith and trust to do that. And then it also helps to have witnesses, mighty companions around you, when the temptation comes in to start building a case or start, you know, holding on to that grievance or that perception that there's been some unfair treatment, to start to loosen that up in the mind, little by little. So, one of the things that you're talking about in terms of the court systems and so forth, we could just talk about justice, whether we're talking about criminal justice or any type of justice in the world. There's a section in the Course called The Justice of Heaven, where Jesus comes right out and he says, there is no justice in this world. And that helps even to hear that, because when the mind is so riveted on being treated right or righting wrongs and trying to turn things around and use the court system or mechanisms of this world, it's almost like being on a treadmill where you put all this time and effort in and it just starts to spin faster and faster. And I have had people over the years that told me almost their horror stories of kind of spinning on that treadmill until it just started to feel extremely insane. Like their anger and their frustrations got to be more and more and more. I had one friend from Michigan who was a lawyer who was a divorce lawyer, and when a couple would come in to get a divorce through him, he had sayings from A Course in Miracles on his wall about forgiveness. And I said, oh, some front, a lawyer who's pointing to these forgiveness lessons when they would come in, because he could feel in his heart that was the most helpful thing that he could do. You know, he was there to really listen, but he was there to point to forgiveness. So it does take practice, and yet the more you are determined to really turn things around and really let things go, then you start drawing for more people, more witnesses in the world, more support for this big turnaround in the mind. And it's, you know, you could say it's a lifelong devotion, a lifelong process to that, but you're in really good company. You really have really good company here. You've come to a great place. You meet friends, you have support. We just had a movie night, and Sundari was saying that she was joining, what you say, riding the energy of when we flew into town, and actually you settled
a lawsuit. Yep.
That had been pending for, I guess, some time. I don't know how long, but it was like there was an energy to it
a couple years,
and then suddenly the guidance started coming in where you knew just what to say, just what to do. And you kind of went through a guided negotiation process, and then boom, it was done. So that's just a good symbol. That's just something last night that Sundari was telling me about, that just of how when you really work it in your mind, then you do get the reflections of that.
That's interesting. Thank you.
You're welcome. Somebody else? Yes.
Yeah, I have a question. I'm kind of like sensitive to my environment, so it's like hard for me kind of be in the world, because I feel like I kind of pick up on different energies. And I feel like if I'm really in a happy, like high state of mind, then I can really deal with the world in a happy and peaceful way. But if I'm going through a hard time, then the world kind of feels like a battleground. So I just want to figure out how to get up to this high state of mind on a more consistent basis.
Yeah. Well, I remember you just came down, I saw you in Mexico down there doing a retreat. Yeah, that was a good experience for that. Do you have anything come to mind for that? Do you ever have any sensitivities to the world?
Yeah! Definitely.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. It's. I feel like, again, like even private thoughts that they don't, like we talked about, you know, expression sessions and that, and just even being in a room without even talking. You know, you can feel it when you're going through the process of watching your mind about everything. And there doesn't even have to be expression sessions, really. You can pick it up. And just that when we're going through that process, it's so important to see that it's actually our own thoughts. It's not other people's thoughts. Because it's so easy to think, oh, they think this and that. But no, what do I think about that or them? Or, you know, that they even exist, that there is even an ego. Because it all brings us down into this heaviness of thinking that it's real, more than just watching them like clouds that go in the sky kind of a thing. Where it just like comes and we watch it. Can I stay? Do I dare to stay in the love here? Do I dare to stay in the love? We're there. Okay, I let it go. And then it comes next clip, and it's like, okay, can I let it go? Can I let it go? Oh. So it's a beautiful watching just of that. And just use everything in the way that it comes in.
The things that we think are in the environment and surrounding us are really just requiring a little tweak in the mind, but yet we need to get into a good habit of turning inward for that tweak, because we're so preoccupied with the problems on the screen, so to speak, the movie screen of the world. And this little one, it first came through Resta, and then Helena did a real catchy tune to it, and it's one of those things you could be washing the dishes or, you know, cleaning the house or whatever, and then your mind's getting washed with this happy tune. And to me, I like these kind of tools. We need really good tools that are catchy, happy, that we can go right with. You know, they don't seem like such a struggle.
Maybe we can sing it together even.
Okay.
Here it is. That's not the reason why. That's not the reason why. The problem's not out there. You have to look inside. Do not be deceived. So what is on the screen? You're holding lines asleep and dreaming bitter dreams. The figures that you see are images not real. Don't blame them anymore if you want to heal.
That's not the reason why. That's not the reason why. The problem's not out there. You have to look inside. That thing that someone did, the words that seem to hurt, are only in your mind. And that's where you must search. You haven't really failed. You haven't really lost. Your problems aren't out there. They're only in your thoughts. No secrets can be kept. Hold all things to the light. For secrecy is death. It lets the darkness hide.
That's not the reason why. That's not the reason why. The problem's not out there. You have to look inside. The thing that someone did, the words that seem to hurt, are only in your mind. And that's where you must search. Forgiveness is the way to see the false as false. My child, the Lord delay, but answer spirits come.
Make the feeling, the healing fun, you know? We can make it fun. We don't have to think of it as a drudgery that we have to work through and struggle through. The more lighter we can keep it, the more playful we can keep it, then I think it just, we start to build a confidence and a momentum, like, I can handle this. I can be lifted up. And it turns the corner. It really does. And then you start drawing more support, you know, it can be people, you know, friends start contacting you, books, movies. We're coming up with so many great movies over the years. We've got our Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment, which is fun. It's maybe in like its fourth or fifth edition or something, and it just keeps expanding and expanding. We have an online Movie Watcher's Guide now. Was it MWGE.org, where we even take the emotions that you work through and we index them. So if you're going through anger, rage, envy, jealousy, you know, whatever, guilt, shame, we actually, you look up your emotion. Imagine, you know, you're going through this emotion, you're trying to deal with it, and you're trying to mantra, you're trying to meditate, but you can't meditate because, you know, you're so stirred up, you're in the thick of the emotion. And then you go, well, let me try this Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment. You go through your emotional index and you find your emotion, and then you are guided to the movie to watch, that while you're sitting back and watching the movie, it will help you break through that emotion. You know how it works with certain movies. You happen to find yourself with just a certain movie and it's a catharsis. You cry, you laugh, you heal. And so I call movies the modern day parables. Jesus taught in parables. Why not let him continue to use the parables like Groundhog Day and all these Truman Show, and there's so many. And some of you might have seen Frozen, the Disney movie. Just recently we were seeing a bunch of them. It could be children's movies like, what was the one, the Lego movie. Was really deep. I'm glad somebody tipped me off that the Lego movie was that deep. It's animation, but it's all about coming to see that you're the one and that your part is essential. And at the very end of this animation movie, suddenly it shifts and you've got a father and a son, Will Ferrell and the son. And isn't that what the Course is about, saying, you know, all of your problems are an authority problem because you think you've separated from God, you can make up a separate identity, and you've got an authority issue going on with God that needs to be healed. But it seems to play out in your daily lives in all these interpersonal ways. But it's really a question of, can I create myself as I wish to be, or am I as God created me, perfect spirit? And that's what's being rinsed away. So I was delighted to see at the end of this animation Lego movie, there was a father and son. The father was trying to control. The son wanted to be more playful and have more sense of freedom and innovation. And the father was using crackle glue to keep all the Legos stuck together. And the son wanted to come up with some new formations. And that was what the whole movie was about. The struggle to find harmony and to have freedom of expression that comes from within. So, you know, it's a really amazing thing. There are so many tools, and if you find your spirituality still seems kind of methodical and dry and repetitive and struggling and challenging, then that's what I've been doing. I know our whole life has been spent making music, doing videos, putting together little worksheets, instruments for peace, doing experiential kind of things. Anything we can come up with that will be helpful to the mind as a tool to make it more fun. And that seems to be a huge thing. Okay, any Sundari?
Well, I'll try to ask a question. okay. So, in listening to the movie last night, I came... The basic question is, there's a screen going on, I know it's my own thoughts projected, and all of a sudden, last night, I saw that judgment and time were the same thing, and that you made a comment that the future and the past are identical. And so, and Helena told this beautiful story, it was like you were almost answering about the van and the rain and the... where we tend to judge what's on the screen. And you've said to me before that there's no origin of what's on the screen. And yet I go, oh, but that's all my own thoughts. And like when I, what I learned from your story was it's all about your feelings and the emotional state one decides to hold, holding the light constantly is the perfection of everything unfolding kind of moment by moment, miraculously. The feelings of synchronicities happening. The thing is, I seem to be judging, even in the synchronicities, looking at the screen and making judgments about it, and judging how I am from what's happening out there, as if it's reflecting my value. And my mind goes back and forth on that, saying, well, that really isn't my value, and yet it gives me a reflection of where I think I am, so I make judgments about it, which puts me in time. And so I'm lost in that little loop of something happening out in the world and thinking my thoughts created it, and yet knowing it's totally meaningless. And I don't have to judge it at all, but I get in this loop of, but that's how I know where I am. So I'm asking how to pop out of that, and where to pop.
The bubble lady's getting there. You got some sound effects going on behind you as you're going on the pop.
We'll burst your bubble. It's a deep place because I can feel this.
Yeah, this is a question for... This is the core question.
Yeah, it is. It's
the core question.
Yeah, well, the dynamic is projection makes perception. And so, what is projection? I mean, you know, we've heard about it in psychological terms, you know, Sigmund Freud and projection as a defense mechanism. But what Jesus says in the Course is... projection is a way to get rid of something that you do not want while keeping it. Mm-hmm. Isn't that a bizarre thing we've got going on with this world? It's an attempt to get rid of something you do not want by keeping it. It's a trick from the ego to seem to make it seem like it's outside when it's just a thought. And that's why, as you go along and you through the healing process, you start to, like, I always think of like a fishing rod, start to reel in the projections. It gets pretty intense, because it goes from, oh, they're to blame, or they did it wrong, or they, to I. And it gets really heavy. I have done this thing, and it is this I would undo. And this is where... more and more turning the thoughts over to the Holy Spirit, more consistently, more transfer of training, handing the thoughts over, it starts to loosen you from this habit of thinking that you are the thinker of those judgmental thoughts. You are the thinker of those attack thoughts. How could you feel anything but guilty if you've got all this attack going on in your mind? A lot of it's pushed out of awareness, but a lot of us know that it's just simmering down there. And even when you try to get into the power of positive thinking and be positive, the attack breaks through. Sometimes it explodes through, it bursts through. In the Lego movie, there was one character was, what was her name?
Unikitty.
Unikitty was so, was pink and positive, yeah. And then underneath, Unikitty has a real rage going on under there, because you can't cover it over, you know, it has to be healed. So, as we were talking about that story of trust, like with the motorhome, and we've had a lot of stories, you start to realize that's why it's called A Course in Miracles, that you can literally become a habitually miracle-minded. You can learn to align with God and have so many miracles that you become more consistently miracle-minded and more consistently miracle-minded. And then you undo the belief that your source comes from outside of you, from jobs or even from the government or from economy or all the things that are believed to be the sustainers of the body. You start to realize that there's a light in you that sustains your very being and is not plugged into any of those things. You can start to loosen from them more and more and more. We call it divine providence. You just live there, and after a while, this happy tune you're singing, this happy, joyful, light way of being that you're tuned into, you start to realize is that you don't need projection. There's no value in projecting anymore. You wouldn't even have a thought of blaming somebody. Even if somebody seems to be angry, growling, or whatever. I know when I went to China, the first time I went there was 100 and some people there, and there was too many people to break it up into small groups, so they just would put a chair there, and they would bring people up, and Chris was editing some of those old China videos. He was reminding me today at our afternoon lunch that one of them was a screamer. She just got up and she just screamed at you, screamed in your ear, loudly. And Jason was the one who went around. He was kind of touching the ones and saying, "You'll be." He was like thinking, "I had to pick a screamer. I mean, David comes all the way across the Pacific Ocean, and I have to pick a screamer out of all these Chinese people." But when you're in a state where you so go within and you've so healed your mind and you've let go of the belief in attack, that even what seems to be a screaming person with a red face in front of you, 2 feet away, there was no sense of defense. There was no sense of reaction to it. You know, you let go of all interpretations, not because you should let them go, but because you never really were capable of judging in the first place. It was an unnatural thing to judge. And the world that got projected out to try to get rid of this unnatural thing was just as unnatural as the judgments themselves. They're really the same. So when we learn to stop judging and we just follow divine guidance, we then can be a blessing to everyone, regardless of what their behavior is. It doesn't mean we're not trying to change behavior at all. We're just seeing that there's no world outside of our mind. That takes a lot of mind training to start to realize there's no world external to your mind. You know, we're not trying to sugarcoat it and just say you can twinkle your nose or click your heels together. It's a course that requires practice, it requires vigilance, it requires, you know, mighty companions showing up to help you when you feel like you're really knocked down low and the ego's got you down in the dirt. You need helping hands along the way. And that's been really the story of how our life has gone. And really, even in our lives, you know, to hang in there and have the faith over these years of whatever the ego intensity would come up, it really was not capable of stopping the peace of mind.
And especially when the light comes through, then the ego just want to roar. So it's beautiful. And we actually had a song coming through recently that is called To See. And it was this beautiful thing. I was in Sweden and I listened to David on the Spreaker talks. He has several beautiful, beautiful talks on Spreaker that you can listen to for probably hundreds and hundreds of hours. And in the course it says, do not see error. And he was given a talk on that speaker saying that when I heard Jesus saying, do not see error, that was just it. That was like, if I, you know, I'm not rephrasing, you know, but if I cannot see any error, that's it. Then that's it. And I just felt to sing that part of the course.
And you can see where innocence goes along with that. If you never saw an error, you couldn't experience guilt. And that's really what this is about, a curriculum in innocence, pure divine innocence. And being guided by the Spirit, that guides you in everything that you're to say and to do. You don't have to react and respond to the world, to the images. You let it source through you, you let it flow through you from that place of innocence. So you're just teaching innocence by your attitude, by your words, by your actions. You're never trying to call attention to error, trying to call attention to mistakes. Most of us were raised, of course, in the ego system is don't do this, don't do that. Here's the rules, don't break the rules. If you break the rules, you get punished. That's been a curriculum in guilt and punishment. And we're being called into a curriculum of innocence, which Jesus calls do only that. If you stay aligned with the source, then you radiate that innocence and you teach that innocence. And the whole world will reflect that innocence as you come to the purity of that. And that's the way out of hell, the way out of thinking you're just so concerned about making a mistake that you get all frozen, all tense, all stressed. And coming into that innocence, starting to really feel that and flow with that. So that's leaving the correction of error to the Holy Spirit, not trying to take it on personally, as if you would know personally what that correction would be. That's just not possible. And it works. That's the thing we're discovering in our communities. There's a harmony, there's a flow, there's a synergy of collaboration. And there isn't competition. The conflicts fade away. And in the end, there's no desire to point out error, because innocence is too precious. You wouldn't want to blot that innocence out of your mind. You want to keep it in your heart, keep it flowing through. So it's the way we're going.
David, yeah, it's a fascinating topic. And the thought I had came to mind was, it's a beautiful, concept, if you will, to try to apply to our lives, or live it that way. But how do you, if you draw in or project a vision or an experience where an error is causing perhaps someone's physical life to be in jeopardy? Mm-hmm. I'm not going back to my father's situation, just creating an image here. How do you accept that or not bring that to someone's attention for correction? And because it would be, in some ways, a personal judgment that there's a problem.
Well, I find that, in my experience, it's that the whole problem of this world is concepts and definitions that have been covering over the truth, and that God and love are undefined, and therefore, even an experience of the definition of life being biological, you know, biological life, human life, right, and so on and so forth. You know, we go from human being, and the emphasis often is on the human part, not the being part. Mm-hmm. And yet all the perennial wisdom says, live in the now, be present, be the one that you are, that you were created, one with God. That's the focus. So I found as I follow Jesus down into my mind, deeper and deeper and deeper, I started to realize that the world that I was defining as human life and life on planet Earth wasn't what I thought it was. not too long ago, Ken Wapnick, great teacher of the Course, passed away, and I remember many years ago listening to a cassette tape way back in the days of cassettes when somebody asked him a question, what does the Course say about life on other planets? And Ken didn't even pause. He said, well, the Course says there's no life on this planet. Great humor and right on. Because what we would say is life on planet Earth is described more as the Course would say is like image making or idolatry. You know how the Bible said, make no images before the Lord thy God. We thought we were talking about, gold totem poles and things like that. He was talking about the whole cosmos, all the cosmic images, that make up all the galaxies and the quasars and everything are all idol images that were made to veil the face of Christ, to cover over this divine love and light. And we're asking that that veil be lifted through forgiveness. So experientially, working with that, somebody told me the story near the end of Ken's life, he just matter-of-factly said, I'm not dying. You teach this stuff long enough. It's like, I'm not dying. Really. Ramana Maharshi, great Indian saint, he said to the followers who started weeping and crying around him with his glowy eyes, even though his frame was getting very skinny and more skeleton-like, he had these glowy eyes, and the words that came out very softly was, where would I go? It was just, have you not been listening? What I've been talking about here, as if there was a grief of passing, like he was going to pass away. Where would I go? He said, just a very simple question. So, to me, the experience, it takes practice. And I've had to practice with the people in my lives, with my cat, my three-legged cat. Tripod, at one point, she looked like a little pirate of the Caribbean, where one eye got real pussy and glossy and looked like she needed a little pirate patch to wear. But through inner practice, of not putting meaning onto the things in form, there was a time when Tripod was very young, and we had this deep telepathic connection, and I was getting so into the miracle that I didn't really, wasn't needing like medical attention and so on and so forth, and we kind of had made a pact or a covenant. We would leave, doctors and veterinarians out of this and really go with the miracle, really practice. And so when she had her eye that was turning all these colors and everything, I just didn't buy into the appearances, and they did go away. It turned into a forgiveness lesson for a friend of mine who was an animal rescuer and was desperately trying to bring in medication and different things. And I said, no, this is all just a lesson in forgiveness. There's nothing harmful going on here at all. And it was a lesson in letting go of appearances. So the deeper we get into this mystical experience and mystical union with God, we feel that life in our hearts. We feel that joy. We feel that love. It's so, so deep. Mm-hmm. And it draws us in, away from the attention on the body and on the belief that life is in form or that life is in time. And it's more like Sundari was just saying after watching Mr. Nobody last night, the very quantum movie, that you start to realize that judgment and linear time are the same. That as long as we think that biological life or life, in form is really life, then we are deceived. We're into idolatry and image making, and we're coming into that sense that life is eternal. And if we don't know life as eternal, then we don't know life at all. And we need to be humble and open our hearts and say, show me, God, you show me. Take me to eternity. Instead of show me the money, show me the eternal. Mm-hmm. Take me there. You can take me there beyond it. Mm-hmm. But you see, it takes a lot of humbleness and a lot of letting go to even let go of those definitions.
Yeah, I have a very fresh example. Actually, the ones that I'm collaborating with right now with the band, The Open Heart, that you could hear here, Ludwig and Al, we actually stayed in a house in Sweden that had a cat in it, And right before we were going to move into it, I said to Ludwig, you know there's a cat, right? And he was like, yep, I'm aware of that. Because the thing is that he thought he'd actually died before when he was like in a house because he couldn't breathe. He had such a bad allergy. And he could like feel it for like at least 2 weeks after he'd been in a house with a cat. And that was like his story. But he said, I need to go to that house. And I need to look at my thoughts about this now. And so we said, okay. Okay, we'll do it then. So we went to this house. There's this beautiful cat, Kotick, who also was all smashed up when we came there. That's why the other house sitters, they couldn't be there because they were like, oh my, he's like suffering, he's suffering. And we were like, oh, he's in bliss. He was really beautiful. And we didn't see that at all. And actually, that was just one part of the story, actually, that just disappeared very quick when we came to. We didn't give false empathy to that at all. We were just like, oh, Kotick, and just cuddled with him. And but the thing is, with Ludwig, he had like a really hard asthma, it seemed like. He could hardly breathe, and at the nights, he almost felt like he was dying every night. And he was praying so deeply, and he was saying, I really want to get rid of this. I cannot have this anymore, and I have to go beyond. I cannot think about the body, and that this is about the body. And these talks about that if we want God more than breathing, then that's something that we can apply literally in a situation like that. And that's what he went into, and he started embracing it. And actually, he had days when he was totally clear. And then he came back again, and then he was totally clear. And then he came back again. So it was this thing that at the end, Kotick, he actually laid in his lap and they were cuddling. And he just fully let go of his thought about that there was anything external that could actually cause, you know, some kind of ripple effect of his breathing. So that's another beautiful example. And I've come to see myself actually being threatened to death by a boyfriend. He was, I never seen anyone so crazy in my whole life, so angry, actually. He threw himself literally at the steering wheel, having the gas down, the pedal down on the floor. And he said, you have to forgive me for what I'm about to do. And I just, as I spoke, it was just getting worse and worse. I was just like, I'll just resign. That's the one and only thing I can do. I just want to be with you, God. I don't want to blame him. I don't want to think that I have created this. I just want to be with you. So I went in, and I was so present that was my one and only desire. No outcome of anything other than that. And we got home. And he said, how can you love me after that? Now, this is a question. How can you love me after that? And I started listening to that question, and I went like, I just felt so much love first, but then I was like, ooh, oops. And I bought the bait. I bought the bait. I thought, I must be crazy. I must be put in a mental institution, probably, because this is a nuts case. Okay, the course is talking about, you know, forgive no matter what, but you're nuts. You're like feeling the love for him here, and you should not feel the love. It just went berserk, because it was so much love that I embraced the presence of God so deeply in my mind, and I saw it. That's where I saw what it says in the course. That we're not most afraid of dying or death. We're most afraid of loving.
Did that change your relationship? The level of your relationship? Or how did it change your relationship?
It did, because I bought into the fears about it. I didn't hold on to that feeling that I'd had in the car. I actually bought the bait. But I can say that I did not buy the bait at all with Ludwig. I did not have any false empathy when he was breathing or anything. I didn't even notice, actually. He was the one telling us. And the thing is, with that true empathy, where you're just watching everything, and you just feel all of the love, and you just join in the love, that's what you were talking about, that you don't see the eye that is gooey, or the breathing, or the whatever it is of the form, because we just embrace that this knowledge that is beyond everything. If we just want to be with that, it is fully possible, and that's what we are being taught in the Course.
No, I don't feel like answering my question, though, as far as if you're, shall we say, conscious of something being, or someone, I know, and we're talking about the physical life here, being in danger, and you have an opportunity to maybe change the course of that instance.
Yeah, I can go into it.
We can look at it as projection.
I can go into it a little bit deeper, because one time in the early years of my travel, I was down in Florida, and there was a philosopher that came to the Course in Miracles group, and his name was Fred, and they pretty much chased him out of the Course group because he had so many philosophical questions, and nobody in the group felt they were at that level to answer him.
Yeah.
And so we were having lunch, and I was inviting everyone to come to my gathering, and Fred was sitting across from me, and I said, "Oh, Fred, why don't you come to my gathering?" And the whole table groaned. And I said, "What's wrong with Fred? Why everyone's so resistant to Fred? Well, you can't answer his questions because they're just too deep and all this and this." I said, no, that's going to spur us on. That's going to help us all.
Yeah.
If he's got some good deep questions, it's going to, the Spirit will come through. And Fred asked that question too. Fred said, because I was traveling with a woman at the time, and in Beverly, and Fred just said, "Now listen, I'm all for this defenseless and turn the other cheek and some of these teachings of Jesus, but the practicality only goes so far." He said, "If you were walking down the street and somebody came up and started to physically attack Beverly while you're walking down the street with her, don't tell me that you're going to turn the other cheek or be completely defenseless, because that's," he said, "you're not going to do that," and everything, this and this. And I said to Fred, I said, that's an interesting question, but it's a hypothetical. And he said, "Well, yeah, it's a hypothetical." So for some of you who have followed my teachings over the year, you start to realize when I go all the way down into the depths of what I call enlightenment, you start to realize that this entire world is a world of hypotheticals. And actually, we watched a movie last night that really showed a lot of hypotheticals. It's called Mr. Nobody, of different relationships, and not in any particular order, kind of like the Wachowski brothers' Cloud Atlas, you know, just a hodgepodge of little snippets and scenarios going on. And the reason when we ask that question about, practically speaking, if someone, you know, was harming another, you know, how can you not intervene, you know, this whole question of hypotheticals come up because whenever we look at problems in terms of attack and defense or protectionism and so on and so forth, they're really all on the timeline. I always tell people, no one has a problem right now. Right now, there's never a problem. Really, if we're honest, we can start to see that we don't have any problems right now, but problems are always remembered or anticipated. Then you start to read the Course, and he starts to say things like, at no single instant does the body exist at all. It is always remembered or anticipated. The problems are remembered and anticipated. The body is remembered and anticipated. In fact, we start to realize that all of our thoughts of time and all of our questions about practical things in time are all time-based. Or I kind of sometimes I in South America I'll talk about quantum physics versus Newtonian. Newtonian, of course, is all linear. It's all based on empiricism, the scientific method, what we learn from deducing, from measuring things and collecting data. And quantum is saying it's all, that's all out the window. It's all consciousness, and everything that you perceive is a reflection of consciousness. So it's your thoughts that you have to work with. Don't think that you know anything about anything in time. It's your thoughts that are making up that hallucination. So, you know, I found that showing that movie last night, I felt was very practical. I know Jen was telling me, she said, oh, I'm ready to take another ride. Because I was giving Holy Spirit commentary on a 2-hour, 20-minute movie. We would probably be there for over 4 hours going through this quantum journey together with the Holy Spirit. And pointing out things. And there's something about the way the movie unfolds, it starts to dislodge your mind from concern. I mean, the movie starts off with a corpse. You know, not a typical way to start a movie, you know. And then it goes, you know, through different drowning sequence and sequence of the body going through all kinds of things. Motorcycle accident, all kinds of different gyrations, relationships, these three little girls sitting on a park bench, and he ends up having, like, in one sense, a relationship with each one in a quantum way, and all these life-death things and things with the body and things that we would categorize, maybe put them on a timeline, we start to feel like, oh, this is not linear. The problem is not linear, and then there's something going on underneath that we have to get in touch with. Because as long as we are not in touch with what's underneath in our subconscious mind, we just keep interpreting things in cause-effect relationships in terms of the world, including harming a body, including those, like Fred's question, your question, the hypothetical questions. So I would say that in my own life, for people that seem to witness the character of David, in the parable of David, I just became more and more and more defenseless until I tell the parable of David. There was one point where I was visiting a friend, and I was just basically visiting her and meditating with her most of the day, but she didn't tell me that she had been divorced for like 2 years, but she had an insanely jealous husband who would go berserk, we're talking like Jack Nicholson, red rum, you know, absolutely berserk, if a man even came close to his ex-wife. And I would sit in there, watch metaphysical movies with her, meditate with her, and his eyeballs would come around in the windows, you know, those glossy kind of eyes, and like saliva coming out of the mouth, and it could have been Jack Nicholson for like, but at one point, you know, in my mind training with the Course, it got to be so deep that at one point she was back on the couch watching one of my metaphysical movies from Movie Watcher's Guide to Enlightenment. I was on the floor watching it with my hand like this and watching the movie, and he came blasting in the door, just blasting in the door. He came right over to me, the man, the enemy. And I was watching the movie, and he just, it was salivating, and his eyes were bulging out, and he was just in a fit of rage and, you know, veins, and just ready to destroy something. And I was seemingly the man, see, but not really. I was in such a state of bliss, and I was watching this movie, and he grabbed my sweatshirt. He started to pull on it, and I was still in the same clothes, not a defensive move being made at all as I'm continuing, but I am looking up at him, kind of probably with a smile on my face as this sweatshirt starts to... And then at that point, you know, I've practiced the Course for many years, you know, if I defend myself, I am attacked.
Yeah.
In my defenselessness, my safety lies. What did Jesus say about turn the other cheek? What did he say about the meek? The meek shall inherit the earth. He didn't say the strong will inherit the earth. He didn't say the the warriors will inherit the earth. He said, what? The meek. I was in my perfect meekness, actually. I mean, divine meekness, and the shirt's getting a little stretched. And just then, his ex-wife, who's like working on Stairmaster, and she's like really fit, comes shooting off the back couch, and she hits him like a linebacker in the NFL, and drives, he couldn't hold on to the shirt, drives this guy across the living room, across the kitchen, and out the door, and the door slams behind him. And I swear there was some blood flying too. I mean, this was a hit, like not even in the NFL. She had adrenaline to the max, and I'm still there. The shirt's a little bit stretched, but I'm still in the same pose. Haven't even moved. Because it's mind training. It's the defenselessness. It's really taking that to be literally the truth from Jesus, that if we are defenseless, if we don't have any bit of attack or defense in our mind, there is nothing more invulnerable than a mind that refuses to judge. You know, like the Bible says, if God is with us, who can be against us? But we have to really give God ascendance in our mind. And so this has worked for me over the years. Even taking a walk, having a growling dog come charging at you, it's just involuntary. I remember I went down like on one knee and my arms went out like to invite the dog, and the dog almost like hit an invisible wall because there was no defense. And when there's no defense, there can be no attack. They go together. And so we have to really apply that, and we only learn it experientially by applying it and applying it, and we don't judge how extreme the situations are. You know, the first principle of A Course in Miracles is there's no order of difficulty in miracles, and then he goes on to say there's no hierarchy of illusions. You shouldn't tell yourself, well, these are times to be defensive and these are times not to be. He's saying, no, apply this lesson. In my defenselessness, my safety lies. You will never try to win an argument. You will never confront. Your very being will be maybe a confrontation to the ego, but not to the spirit. And you can be completely uncompromising in this and unswerving, and you can make an unequivocal decision to stay in meekness, and everything will shift. Cancer will disappear from your perception. Heart disease, you know, Mary Baker Eddy, there were Christian scientists who famously would have like an entire arm eaten away, we'll say by cancer or something, and go into the Christ mind, and the whole arm gets regenerated. I mean, we have sci-fi movies where that happens, you know, like, what was the one with Jeff Bridges, Tron, where the ISO, you know, one of her limbs just completely is regenerated. We call that science fiction, but actually the form is not where the causation is. It's when the mind is invulnerable, then the form will just be used as long as it's necessary. And we can go so fully into that that it actually works. So for me, I tell a lot of parables because Jesus told me early on that this course is not a play in ideas. This is about going for an experience, an actual experience. And he said, make your invulnerability manifest. And I thought, well, the only way I'm going to do that is be extremely meek and not have a shred of confrontation in me. And that, I found, is very, very effective.
Yeah, and actually the continuation of the parable that I was giving, of course, I mean, I didn't live with him anymore after that, but what I wanted to say was also that, I mean, he was calling in the middle of the night once at the monastery, and it was like all of this love just pouring through, the spirit just opening up, like so vast, and it was this, oh, thank you. It was like no words, you know, it was like that presence just coming through again. And everyone recognizes that, and we don't even have to be in the same room for that. Even it's just beyond.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Dave, thank you for that explanation. Because I was wondering too. You said earlier you were talking about being confronted with a screamer in China, and what tools that you developed to handle that situation, and you pretty much answered in your parable there.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Is there another song trickling around?
Yay.
There's a song, all right.
I kind of felt like my sister was like my other half. And when she was 18, she actually ended up dying in a really random, seemingly tragic house fire accident. And in the world, you know, there's just so much like, oh, this is a tragedy. This is tragic. And I remember when it was so weird because it was such a telepathic experience that I already knew something had happened. But I remember when it was like uttered the words, like, I don't know how I'm going to tell you this, but your little sister died. It was like this moment of being the dreamer in the dream. And I was like, wait a second. This isn't real. And I didn't really know what it meant, but I was kind of latched into this mystical experience for a while of just, I didn't sleep and I was so happy and I loved everybody. And just this remembrance that it's, that only the love is real. And it's an experience, it's something to be experienced. And it's really just a falling away of everything that's blocking that. I had no context really for what happened after she died, and I kind of got lost, and then I kind of was like, I got to a point where I was like, oh my God, I'm so lost. I'm going to get on my knees every day and pray to who knows what because I'm just so lost. And I ended up finding the course and I found David. And I was like, oh my God, somebody out there just is speaking of this experience that I had. And so when that time came through, this song came right through. And it speaks to that.
Harm the truth, it's time to undo.
Yeah, that's really what we're into is, you could say it's like practical spirituality. So the more you tune your mind into the spirit, then the fruits of the spirit come through songs, many, many songs for both of them, and things just become involuntary. So that's why I say when I just show up, that's all I'm required to do is just kind of show up, and then the spirit gives the words. The spirit speaks through. It's joyful, it's light, it's playful, it's animated. You know, the spirit loves us so much, and so much undoes the doer. You know, songs coming through in a flesh, like the idea of writing songs, that sounds more like Mozart used to have concertos come through in a flesh, just showing us it could be done. It wasn't a long process. You know, and he's talking about this, his favorite part of the music was the gaps of silence between the notes. Well, that's going quantum. That's going before there was a quantum. Mozart was going quantum. We've got great examples of that. And really, what we have felt that the spirit is so practical that the spirit will take you into an experience using what you believe in and loosening the limitations from your consciousness so that you have more and more transcendent experiences. And it happens seemingly gradually at times just so you can adapt and adjust. Nothing's ripped away. Nothing's taken away. There can be some times on a spiritual journey, like it's more like Dan Millman's book, The Way of the Peaceful Warrior, which is kind of accelerated. For most people, they would say that was kind of an accelerated undoing. You know, motorcycle crashes and extreme, you know, leg having to be shattered and then kind of rebuilt. But actually, if we're willing, we can give ourselves over to the spirit, follow that guidance. Even if you don't hear the voice, you still get your intuitions, your feelings, you get signs and symbols around you, cues and clues, and if you start to follow, then that helps you feel more harmonious with the spirit, more in alignment with purpose, and your life just will get lighter and lighter. You may have egoic reactions to this, where the ego is trying to tell you you've failed, you're going to be a failure. If you continue on, you're going to end up in some kind of failure scenario. But the deeper you loosen your your mind from these judgments, you start to realize that failure is just a judgment. And that even in the Course in Miracles, Jesus says you can't judge your advances from your retreats. And that's where we are mighty witnesses to each other, where the world would be tempting to say that we're failing at something. Our peace of mind is showing that we are advancing in maturity, in our experience of being the Christ, of being the One, like in the Matrix. So that's one thing that I've enjoyed about traveling and sharing so much, is because we come together with our sincerity, our questions and our answers, and we do gain in experiences. We open our hearts up, we have more broad, vaster experiences, and they really show us that there's something beyond the everyday perceptions of the world, that we're really not stuck. We may claim that we're stuck, but we're really not stuck. We're just on a pathway of opening. And even though the ego will try to even judge the progress, you know, we're not really capable of even doing that. And when we stop for an instant, we realize how joyful it is. So to me, I'm very, very grateful for these kind of gatherings, because we come together with such openness and sincerity, and every single time we are blessed. Every single time we're a little bit lighter, we're a little bit looser. And ultimately we know that it's going to, there's going to be a conversion, a transformation, which is going to transcend the ego entirely. And it's inevitable. You know, we might as well not fight it,
yeah,
because we're being lifted up into that. Yeah.
I have a little share.
Yeah.
It's funny. It's right in alignment, I believe, with what you just were sharing there. Yesterday I was in my office and I was working with Val, and there was all kinds of stuff happening. For those that don't know, I'm a children's entertainer. I work with bubbles. I'm the bubble-it. Okay. That's just one part. And there's, I think, another company coming up. And there's what you might be considered in the world as competition. And you know, where there wasn't anymore before. And I saw my mind have this thought of an oh no. It was just an instant of a oh no, what if. But then I was sharing with Val, it's okay, because I'll have whatever jobs I'm meant to have, whatever, anyway, because the script is written. So we were laughing and going on and all that. But today, I had a show at a school in doesn't matter where it was. And there was about 130 kids between 5 years old and 10 years old, plus the teachers. It was a very, very joyful experience. And everybody joined, even the kids with attitude at the beginning. We all had such a lot of fun. And at the end, a few 10-year-olds came up to me, and they were expressing their joy and how they loved it so much. And they said, "You are the greatest bubble lady, and nobody could ever take your place." I am not kidding. And I heard that. And I got it in that second. I laughed and laughed inside myself. Oh my God. That was the whole thing. And I said, how did it go? I go, yeah, it's a dream. And I made that up. And it just happened. And I saw my mind.
Yeah.
It was so clear and so perfect. And I just had to laugh. Whereas in the past, I might have go, oh, isn't that nice? And the ego would be pampered and all of that stuff. But it wasn't that at all. It was just a real moment of, like you said, the loosening, the undoing, the seeing it all, and just getting the pure joy and chuckle out of what was really going on.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to share
it's
that.
Beautiful. Like you were saying, your part is essential, and no one can take your place. No one can.
Yeah.
And play your part.
That's actually what I want to say. I invite you in to see whatever there is to see. So the invitation is here. Thank you
yeah.
very much.
Yeah. That's beautiful. Yeah, you start to see everything that's in your awareness is a message to yourself.
Yeah.
And you really got that one. Like, oh my gosh, this is the answer to my trickle of a doubt thought.
Yeah. And I just had to laugh because it's so instant. It was so quick, you know, like the next day. And I did it and I said, okay, well, I'll just keep doing it. Whatever you want, Holy Spirit, you show me.
Yeah.
I'm here to serve.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, Rebecca.
Yeah, that's the invitation to the Holy Spirit too. Like we all can do that all the time, which is just hand it over, like all the time.
Yeah.
And we do get the answer straight away.
It is miraculous.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for sharing.
Yes.
I'm not sure if this is a question. I don't even know how it's going to come out. But it's like we're saying, yes, I'm surrendering to the Holy Spirit, right? Mm-hmm. And so the ego's not saying that. Right? So whoever or whatever, probably better description, adjective is what, whatever's saying that, is so joining with the Holy Spirit that whatever said that is melted into, so there's no more subject and object. It just is the Holy Spirit, right? And that's the process that we're evolving as one, as into. So whoever says, I'm surrendering God, eventually nobody's even doing that.
Yeah?
Right. Ooh.